So the topic of tonight is the 62 storm. Peggy gave me 2 hours to talk tonight, is that right? Okay. But she did steal my first question, which was how many of you were here? So I will change it up a little bit. Who was president in 1962? Okay. My research says Kennedy until 63. Let's see here. What else was going on? There was troop escalation in Vietnam starting to kick off around then. Civil rights movement obviously was alive and well then. Marilyn Monroe died later on that year in 62. Manned mission to the moon, that didn't happen until 69. Cassette tapes introduced in 62 by Philips. Yep, so no iPads, DVDs, 8-tracks are beginning to exit the scene. And then we also have some music. Lion Sleeps, I'm not gonna sing these songs, by the way. I'm gonna assume that you remember these songs. If you're a basketball fan, Wilt Chamberlain, in March, 100 points. I believe later that year, Sonny Liston beat Floyd Patterson. Getting ready for Muhammad Ali soon after. So many of you were here during the storm. How many of you remember some of the impacts of the storm? How many experienced power outages? How many of you experienced flooding in your homes? Vehicles? Vehicle damage? A lot of the hazards that we face now with nor'easters and hurricanes aren't much different than they were back then. The technology is a little better. The ability to communicate and anticipate storms has certainly got a lot better. But the storms are storms, and Mother Nature hasn't changed. We just have and tried to adapt to it. It's kind of interesting. So when we go back in time, the forecast technology, when you think about the 1900 storm of Galveston, which I know nobody here was there, for the 1900 storm, but the technology then versus now. I'm sure so many of you probably watch the tide data that we get from Sewell's Point. We get information obviously from the Weather Service in Wakefield and 310-13, I mean the Weather Channel apps. There's all kinds of ways that we can get forecast information to see storms and events coming our way. And it's improved a lot more since 1962. Incidentally, 1962, the Weather Service, I think, was in operation for about 100 years. They started in about 1860s. And so when you think about climate data in general, it's only a small slice of time where we had that recorded history from the Weather Service. And history books, narratives, diaries from ship captains and other historical figures, they count towards historical data, but it's not official data that we get from the Weather Service and their technology. So that's really a small slice of that pie versus obviously the extent of our existence. So here's a snapshot of the 62 Ash Wednesday storm. And if you can imagine the size of a hurricane, and we're gonna get to the difference between a hurricane and a nor'easter in a little bit, but you imagine a storm coming off the Atlantic and working its way up, or a direct shot this way, it's really kind of small compared to what a nor'easter can be. And when we think about the impacts of the 62 Ash Wednesday storm, there was snow, and then the coastal impacts right here. And again, the sheer size, when you think about it, and when you see the headlines going from Carolina up to New England, it was a pretty significant event. So it occurred in early March, and so the beginning of the storm started with the snow that went to the Piedmont area and the mountains. It happened during a spring tide. So if you can imagine, and without getting too technical, and there are maybe even meteorologists in here could explain it better than I do, but obviously the moon impacts the tides, right? As does the sun. And so when they are in alignment, that is a spring tide and even greater tidal effects. So it just happened to happen during a spring tide. The storm moved off the coast, past Virginia Beach, and we'll see some pictures of what it looked like in Virginia Beach. And the way it was positioned bring higher tides than usual. And again, the impacts of a nor'easter versus a hurricane, there are constant tides that continue to diminish the beaches, beach erosion, and so much more impacts. around 9 feet, and I'll show you a table of where the 62 Ash Wednesday storm fit compared to other storms in our history. Winds were recorded up to 70 miles per hour, which is about hurricane force winds that once it reaches 72. And the snowfall wasn't such a big thing for us, but again, it was in other parts of the Commonwealth. Over 40 fatalities, and this is storm-wide. This isn't necessarily Norfolk or just Virginia. This is storm-wide, and 1,200 injured. That's a mass fatality event, 40 fatalities. When, again, with the technology that exists and the way that we're able to communicate, zero should be the number. A nor'easter should not kill. It's the water. It's always the water. Surge is the number one killer for tropical storms and nor'easters, and that's our approach for evacuation. And we'll talk about evacuation sometime. I don't know if you want to do that tonight. But you run from the water and hide from the wind. That's the strategy. This shouldn't happen. Devastated 620 miles of shoreline. Again, you saw the extent of that storm from Carolina to New Hampshire. Pretty big storm with more than $300 million in damages. Incidentally, I guess the true emergency manager in me, it seems like the costs of damages continue to increase every year, right? Incidentally, the trend of people living closer to the water is increasing every year. So God made floods. Man makes disasters, right? So we have to be smart with how we develop, where we develop, make sure that when we rebuild, we're doing so in a resilient manner that takes into account that Mother Nature is going to win, and we have to make sure that we adopt and adapt accordingly. Again, the snowfall precipitated the coastal storm, which occurred in the 6th and the 7th. So real quick, the difference between a nor'easter and a tropical storm. Yes. Hurricane season is from, anyone know what hurricane season is? June through November, exactly. Nor'easters can happen now. Let's see, so strongest in the winter. We could talk about the low pressures and the cold versus the warm inside the center of the eye of the storm. Okay, hurricanes generate higher storm surge. And I'll just put it to you this way. One, we're above sea level, right, versus Katrina in New Orleans. So a lot of folks are concerned. They see the images from New Orleans and people crawling out of their attics to get saved. That shouldn't necessarily be an issue here unless we're hitting a catastrophic storm. We should have storm surges, but we're looking at, you know, 9-10 feet, and then the storm's going to come in and the storm's going to recede. It may be a few tide cycles, but with a hurricane, it's coming in, whether it's slow moving or fast, which obviously impacts the storm surge that we're going to experience. But the storm's going to come in, the water's going to come in, we're going to get flooding. If you didn't know, we get flooding in Norfolk. We get flooding in Norfolk, and then the water is going to recede. And then we have the nor'easter. So so this was a nor'easter, a winter storm. It was a nor'easter. Anyone remember the twin nor'easters in 2009? Same thing. Okay, so you understand the stacking tide effect. So while a hurricane is going to come in and it's going to go out, the effects on the tide from a nor'easter, the stacking tide effects, the storm's going to come in, the storm surge is going to come in, and when low tide comes in, that doesn't mean the water is receding. It's going to come in another high tide cycle and not recede. It's going to come in another high tide cycle and not recede. There are five high tide cycles with this storm right here. And so the impact on flooding is really no surprise of a storm of this magnitude. So I'm sure many of you have seen these maps, correct? Especially if you live in Norfolk, you should have seen these maps. There's a big difference, and it's frustrating sometimes because when there's a storm coming up, a lot of folks push that map on the left-hand side. That is our storm surge map. It is based on beyond worst case scenario. It takes into account a modeling program that we use, and it models different storms from different directions at different intensities to determine where those highest ground levels are. And so from a planning perspective, say that we wanted to build a school or we wanted to build some sort of critical infrastructure, this can tell us, or we want to identify where we want to have our storm shelters. That storm on the left, or that map on the left, shows there's areas that could potentially flood during a storm. So those areas in red could potentially flood during a Cat 1 storm. And then you go to the different levels, Cat 2, Cat 3, Cat 4, and those areas could potentially flood. So from a planning perspective, these are great maps. Realistically, however, If there's a storm coming off, off the Atlantic heading our way, there are other tools and other means by which we can determine where more realistic flooding is going to occur. So there's acronyms, slosh, moms, meows, all these things that we use, which are goofy sounding, but we're able to take the parameters of a given storm, again, the size, the strength, the speed, the direction, to really ascertain better where those flooded areas are gonna be. Now, the map on the right is the flood insurance rate maps. So that's historic data that flood insurance companies use to base your premiums. I won't ask how many folks in here have flood insurance, but it's a good thing to have. Certainly if Hurricane Matthew showed us anything, my predecessor, if anyone knows Jim Talbot, fantastic guy. If you live in a place called Tidewater, that is what we call a clue. Now, again, not everyone has to have it. Just be cognizant of where you are, where your neighborhood is. And it doesn't necessarily have to mean coastal flooding. It could be rainfall as well. We have some antiquated stormwater systems. So, or your neighbor's swimming pool can bust and flood your house. There are things that can happen. In fact, I think the stat is 25 to 30% of the flood insurance claims come from folks who don't live in a flood zone. So if you're not in a flood zone, that's fantastic, and the rates are a lot cheaper, and you have that peace of mind. One thing that folks don't know is it takes 30 days for a storm or for a flood insurance policy to go into effect. So when we see that storm coming out across the Atlantic heading our way, that's not the time to get it. It's going to take 30 days. So. And I will tell you, too, FEMA will tell you with a quickness that, so again, we went through Hurricane Matthew, and there was a lot of individual assistance. And you can apply for that, that's fine. And it's usually for those who are under-resourced, who don't have flood insurance or not adequate insurance. But the process by which you get that money and often have to pay that money back, it's so much quicker and more streamlined when you have flood insurance. So please, just take a look at your property. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. We'll give you the best guidance that we can to make sure that you make the best decision possible. So again, the difference between a hurricane and a nor'easter. These are this is the tide gauges from Sewell's Point. Again, this is one of the most reliable gauges on which we rely. There are a couple others, and it shows different high tides, spread out in different times. But this is the Sewell's Point tide gauge. This one on the left is during a hurricane. So you see, here's normal tides down here, and here's a baseline right here. This is just normal day to day. This is where the tides are. This is a hurricane, so we get that storm surge coming in to that level of moderate activity. And it stays a couple times, and then it starts to work its way down. This is what we mean by stacking tides. So this is from a nor'easter, and the tides are just coming in and coming in. And even with low tide, it's still higher than other times where it would be an extremely high tide based on our baseline down here. So this is several high tide cycles. And then once the storm goes by, you see it drop significantly. But again, the nor'easter provides a lot more flooding, a lot longer duration than what a tropical storm or hurricane might provide. Any questions about the difference between a tropical storm or a nor'easter? So the 62 hurricane, it had those five tide cycles, right? It had that significant level of flooding from Carolinas up to New Hampshire. And this is Virginia Beach right here. So I mentioned Jim Talbot earlier. He told me that there's a rumor, and he can't find factual evidence yet, that many of the vehicles that were damaged during the storm out in Virginia Beach were actually buried right in here. So I don't know. I didn't look and see if the EPA existed in 62, but that's a rumor. We can't confirm nor deny. But obviously, again, the boardwalk looks a lot different today than it did back then. And that's because the late 90s, 96 through 2000, is when they started their beach replenishment project. So the beach is a lot longer and the flood wall is higher. And so the hotels, motels, are very much protected from at least a tropical storm, Cat 1, possibly Cat 2, in that area. Now, again, if a nor'easter hits, they're still gonna have beach replenishment issues. It's still gonna eat away at that sand that's there. It's funny, and Grommet Island Park, for those who have been to the beach down towards, First Street, the accessible park, they will they'll put dunes around the park to protect it from the wave activity coming in, because again, it will still cause damage, and there will have to be replenishment afterwards. Now, the funny thing is, one technical piece as it pertains to the response and recovery is FEMA versus not FEMA. This is a project that Virginia Beach participated with the Army Corps of Engineers. And so when there's public assistance available funds for government infrastructure, public buildings and the like, not eligible for FEMA assistance. So they have to go through the Corps of Engineers for that. Jim Talbot provided some of these headlines from an auction that he got. The auctioneer advertised them as some storm that happened in Pennsylvania. And what he meant to say was the peninsula. So these are headlines from the Daily Press and Hampton, Newport News, and the like. This mentions 1933. That is our storm of record here. The 62 storm is not. It's been worse. And again, I don't assume anyone was here during the 33 storm, but that is the largest level that we have recorded here in Norfolk. And that's the level to which we plan at a minimum, and we usually add a little more to that. It's in the downtown area. Granby is one of them. I think it was Commerce Street, another. Matter of fact, I think the next one, yeah, City Hall Avenue, right there. So I did want to mention both of these pictures. Well, one, he's smoking a cigarette in front of a kid, and that probably wouldn't be the way they operate today. But we've worked with the military big time. I mean, Gene Lambert is their civilian emergency manager for Naval Station Norfolk. Ruth Reich is with Navy Mid-Atlantic on the same campus. We work with them. We serve the same community, essentially. There are so many dependents, family members of our armed, our warfighters in the community that we work side by side. So if you ever wonder if we are in sync with what they're doing, the answer is yes. We've incorporated, you've heard Team Norfolk, the concept Team Norfolk. It is inclusive on the emergency operations side. It's inclusive of public, private, not-for-profit, higher education, and military. We plan together, train together, exercise together, and we respond together. We're unique in that when we have an emergency operations center briefing, and the emergency operations center is where we all get together to talk about, you know, how we're going to respond to a different, to whatever the event is, we have a better battle rhythm, a checklist, countdown, this many hours out, these are the actions that we're taking. That's inclusive of all of our partners. And that way, we don't have to wonder who's doing what. We know who has what resources, how long those resources could be deployed. We have those relationships to call those folks, so we're not exchanging business cards during a disaster. So it's really, we've been able to accomplish something here that's quite unique. Now, obviously, we can't have everybody in our Emergency Operations Center, so we include them via conference bridge. And again, we have backup mechanisms for if we lose cell towers or if we lose power and the like. But we bring everybody in, either virtually or physically, we are talking together. Same thing with winter storms. We work so closely with Norfolk Public Schools, with the Navy, again, our largest employer, our higher education institutions. So the things that we do aren't, you know, in our own silos of excellence that we're actually taking into account. Okay, schools are gonna close this time. Well, maybe we should have folks out of here by this time. We need to make sure that we try to let folks know ahead of time as much as possible, preferably the night before, based on the best information that we have at the time, so folks could plan accordingly. All that is done with so much coordination. I wish that we can communicate to you all that's which is going on. And so we try to, as best we can, whether it's social media, the website, through our impact center, through the traditional media, to Channel 48, which is our favorite cable station of all time. So again, every means possible, high tech, low tech, we're trying to get that message out. So, but here's a list of the different storms that we have. And when we communicate with our Team Norfolk partners and we communicate with the community itself, I try to provide context. So if we're gonna have a flooding event and it's going to be like it was in 2009 or like it was a couple years ago when we had a nor'easter, I usually try to say that so folks can put, you know, some sort of relevance to, you know, just saying it's gonna be 7 feet or 8 feet above whatever the datum is. And so you'll see that one says MLLW, mean lower low water. Does anyone know what that is? I don't even, no, I'm kidding, I do know. It's, so you look at those tides, right? Let me go back. So when you saw the tide charts that I had, and it went like this, right? So you had the high tides up here and the low tides down here. Mean lower low water means the average of those two tides, those two low tides. And mean higher high water is the average of those two high tides. And so when you see a chart that says mean lower low water, that's what it's referring to. And then you have these datums right here. So I think one of them, I can't hardly see, I think one of them is mean lower low water. One is NAVD 88. One is mean sea level. And there's all kinds of confusion. So the Weather Service may be predicting flooding at one level based on one datum. The media may be saying another one based on another datum. We have a fantastic tool named Titan, the tidal inundation tracking for Norfolk, although that would be Titan. But it's Titan, and I'll show you what that means later on. But we have to provide a conversion there as well, because the tide chart that it's relying on is it has to do that conversion from apple to orange to make that program work. It's a great program if you put in the right information, because if you don't, if you're just looking at the numbers, it's going to be skewed and give you something that's totally not realistic. And so again, I'll provide those when I put information out. I put information out through our means, through our department, and our department puts out information that gives a summary of exactly what's going on. So I'll share with you how you can get my information as well as what the city's putting out as well. So FEMA assistance. We mentioned there was about $300 million of damages. Right now, that would be a pretty significant storm. That's more than what we had for Hurricane Matthew, and we had a federal declaration. So the legislation that was in effect back then in 1962 was the Federal Disaster Relief Act of 1950. And all that was that the president could take action independent of Congress to assist a locality or localities from who experienced a disaster with a maximum of a $500 million or $5 million budget. That's not much. And again, $300 million in this storm versus $5 million that's available. Now, some of you may remember Hurricane Betsy down in New Orleans, and Johnson was president. Interestingly enough, he's the first president who went down there. He was actually supposed to get an operation. One of his political power friends down in New Orleans encouraged him to come down because New Orleans was hit so hard. And so he changed his plans, went down there, got off the plane along with his attorney general, someone from the CDC, FEMA didn't exist yet, and some others. And he said, you know what? I'm your president. I'm here to help. I'm going to release whatever resources that you need. And that was a precedent. Compared to what it is now, that was a precedent. That was the first time that really happened. So soon after, Disaster Relief Act of 1966 authorized a 50% cost share. That's more in line with what we have right now. So the Hurricane Matthew expenditures that we had to put forth, FEMA will pay 50% of that as long as there's a federal declaration. That federal declaration process did not exist Relief Act of 1974. And direct assistance to those who are displaced, those who are in need. And so you see the evolution of federal assistance. FEMA didn't come into play until the Carter administration in 1979. And it's kind of interesting. So after 9/11, when we saw all of these departments come into the Department of Homeland Security, the newly formed Homeland Security, that's exactly what happened with FEMA. There were so many different departments doing their own thing with some sort of federal assistance that they were then combined under a new department called FEMA. And then 1988, the Stafford Act, the Robert T. Stafford Act was put into place, and that is essentially our emergency management Bible. That determines and dictates who's eligible for what, how that process is to be done at the local and state and federal level. It's a lot of dry reading, but I read it so you don't have to. And so it determines for individual assistance and public assistance. So the homeowner and the property owner and the business owner, and then the government, and how we might be eligible for different reimbursements based on the actual disaster. So to the gentleman's point, the flood wall came, it started in the late 60s, 68, 69. then constructed and finished in the 70s for $5 million. And I will show you what areas it covers and protects as it pertains to flooding. But I do want to mention that if you're on the web, we have norfolk.gov/flooding, where we talk about all these projects, not only the flood wall from before, and the fact that it actually needs to be increased more, because when you think about sea level rise and the seas are rising in Norfolk, that when the Corps of Engineers reevaluated the effectiveness of the flood wall, we have to bring it up a little higher. And so we have information on that. We have information of Ghent, The Hague, Pretty Lake, all the other areas that we experienced some severe flooding, and the strategies that we're trying to take to get us out of this mess. Now, I will say, again, if you saw, we have maps and we've done presentations that showed the first 50 square miles of Norfolk. I know Peggy has that information as well. So you if you've seen that map, it's, you know, when you look over where Waterside is now, those first 50 square miles of Norfolk. I'm sorry?
Acres.
Well, thank you. Yes, acres, even smaller. And so outside of that, you see a lot of wetlands, right? A lot of marshlands, wetlands, and the like. That's where the water wants to go. It wants to go where it went before. And so those are the same areas that we're experiencing flooding now in those various neighborhoods. So from those first 50 square acres to where we are now, it's a couple hundred years to get us to where we are. And I won't say that it's because of bad development, because there were other threats that we respond to as well. Anyone remember what happened in 1853? Yellow fever. The Benjamin Franklin, 1855, thank you. There's that little obscure monument on Hampton Boulevard for the victims of yellow fever. Yellow fever, spread by mosquitoes, right? And where do mosquitoes like to go? Marshlands, wetlands. So, you know, if they were trying to fill in those areas to protect themselves from the spread of disease, in addition to development. So all that said, it took us a long time to get to where we are today, and we're not going to be able to solve all of our flooding problems overnight. And so we have a strategy, and as funding comes available and better rebuilding strategies, we have great recovery strategies, we will get ourselves out of that. But that's where we are now, and all of that is in here, and again, available a phone call away. Just contact me, and I'm happy to talk about all that we're trying to do to respond to any and all threats facing our community. So here is the flood wall. And a lot of people don't even know it exists. When we talk to folks, we have such a transient population, and so many folks who haven't been here for a while, they see that wall along Waterside and over by Nauticus, have no idea that it's a flood wall. But it's an effective one. And so it protects all these areas, all these businesses. I mean, we're talking millions of dollars of savings and prevention in these areas around downtown Norfolk. And we're looking at other strategies elsewhere throughout the community as well. My office, we take care of home elevations. Has anyone had their home elevated? Okay. And it's a pretty stressful process because you're going through three levels of government. And in order to be eligible, you have to have filed flood claims to be determined a repetitive loss property or a severe repetitive loss properties. Because if you're not filing claims, then it's not costing FEMA any money. And so they figure that you can just, you know, you keep going as you're going. And a lot of folks don't want to file claims because your premiums go up, right? So those who are repetitive loss properties and severe repetitive loss properties, we're able to work with FEMA to get them grants that will cover at least 75% of the cost to elevate their homes. The application process can take up to a year, depending on how many properties are in a project, and sometimes there are 6, 8, 10 projects. It's based on the contractor's schedule. It could be another year before you're able to get up there. And the problem, really, for us, the challenge is that there's really no competition. There is one or two companies that bid on these projects. So if you are in that business and would like to elevate properties, that's exactly what we're looking for. But at the same time, we elevate onesies, twosies, all these other areas that, you know, again, if they're eligible, what we're looking to do is maybe capture the benefits of what those costs would be for each home. And you'd be surprised how much it costs to elevate a property. $175,000 usually. if it's being paid by FEMA. If it's the property owner paying out of pocket, then it's around $40,000, $50,000. So the contractors know exactly what's available to them, and so they'll mark it up as much as possible. So, but again, whether it's $40,000 or $175,000, we could take, if we could protect this group of homes, six, seven, eight, a dozen homes, versus the cost of a more watershed level, regional, or neighborhood level project, those are the things that we're trying to do. Being smarter in our development instead of doing the onesies, twosies. So that's, again, I used to have a full head of dark hair before I got into emergency management and had to deal with these issues. That's just one of our challenges right there. But again, we're doing the best we can to get folks the need to meet their needs. So there is technology, again, that we have available. Again, we use high-tech and low-tech methods. We have a fantastic IT department and a very proactive GIS department. GIS, Geographic Information Systems, the folks who give us maps. And if you're like me, I like to see pictures. I can see data all day long and it's gonna gloss over, but if I see pictures, that's exactly what really communicates the threat to me. And so we're able to look up properties, we can see what flood zone they're in, what surge zone they're in, and then we can take the parameters of a storm and put what the expected tide is going to be after we do that conversion, and we'll get a map that looks like that. You can zoom in down at your street level. And again, this is technology that we did not have in 62 that we have now. So we have progressed, we've come a long way to be able to respond adequately to a flood threat. That's Titan. What does that say? Tide inundation tracking application for Norfolk. So I was close. And there's a bigger picture of that. So again, that just shows you the conversion right there. This is 7 foot of flooding, and the tide chart's going to say 5.5 NAV to 88. So we do the conversion for you. We tell you that it's 7 foot flooding, and that's what it's going to look. And you can zoom in and zoom out as much as you want. And if you don't have a computer, you don't have internet access, we can help answer these questions for you. We have our impact center. Again, our impact center, 664-6510, fantastic. They ramp up when we have an incident. They're there to answer your questions. And if you have questions from the Emergency Operations Center, they'll get you answers. And then again, that's something else that didn't exist back in 62. It had always been, especially when you think about the civil defense days, it's just push information out to the community. Just give them the orders that you need to shelter in place, you need to evacuate, whatever it is, we're just going to tell you what to do. There's a fantastic book by Amanda Ripley called The Unthinkable, Those Who Survive Disasters and Why. And she explains, I mean, very clearly, that it's not enough to just give people orders. You have to give them the why behind it. And usually during the heat of the battle is not when you want to give them the why. Hopefully it's conversations like this or just having planning and training meetings, town halls throughout the year to explain why, look, if you live in this area over here, the importance of getting flood insurance or what your evacuation routes might be. Or again, just having those discussions so folks have a general awareness of not only our plans and not only the opportunity to challenge our plans, but understand the whys and the hows behind those plans. Because frankly, our plan, it's all of our community plan. And if it's just me and my shop in our office writing these plans, they're not going to be effective at all. And so, again, taking into account, opportunities to discuss these plans, show with you the resources that exist, that's how we're going to be resilient and get through whatever nature comes our way. Again, our GIS department captures information that's reported to us or that which is captured by different flood gauges. So we know that there are certain areas that flood consistently. And so when we try to get mitigation grants, be it through FEMA or the USGS or HUD or otherwise, we have data. We've had data going back several years now to prove that these streets, these areas flood consistently, whether it's from precipitation or from coastal flooding. But without the data, it doesn't exist. And so we, again, the IT department here, our GIS folks have done a fantastic job capturing that information and relying on folks out in the community to give us that information so we can be captured and we can get the funding that we need to address some of the projects that we have going on here in Norfolk. Just to show you a couple other tools that we have, again, I mentioned something called SLOSH, Sea Lake Overlay Surge from Hurricanes. SLOSH sounds like an appropriate tool to deal with flooding. It's getting a lot better. Again, so we can tell, based on the parameters of the storm, the strength, speed, direction, what areas could potentially flood, and it really kind of gives us a visual of where we might need to evacuate. P-surge, probabilistic storm surge, comes from the National Hurricane Center 48 hours before the arrival of tropical storm force winds. It tells us from the ground level, forget about mean lower low, mean higher height, NAVD and all that, from ground level, we're expecting this many feet. That's what we need, and that's what we need to communicate to you. Because when the maps that we used to have that didn't even exist in 62, they would just show these areas of various colors means it's gonna get wet. So you can see this area in blue that determined that suggested there was gonna be flooding, but it never differentiated between 3 inches or 3 feet. And so again, the tools that we have now will tell us that, and we can have a better awareness of what we need to do, because whether you need to move your car or whether you need to go to higher ground, these tools are getting better and better to give us that information. Now, I wish that we can get information even sooner, and I won't talk about the evacuation, but for a catastrophic storm heading our way, that timeline for lane reversal, that starts at 120 hours before the arrival of tropical storm force winds. 120. So if you know, and that's when action is taking place. They'll meet 140, but do you know where the storm is 140, 120 hours out? It's nowhere near around here, in most cases. It's not even near the islands. And so there's a lot of decisions that have to be made, and it has to be made that early, because if we're going to do a lane reversal, and the governor has the authority, not us, to do the lane reversal, people have to have a place to go. And so they have a list of shelters, higher education institutions, college, universities, that will start to receive people. They have to be on notice to get their stuff all set and cancel whatever schedule they have. Security is provided by Virginia State Police. Those red and white gates are staffed by State Police, National Guard, and VDOT. And so all those folks have to be called in and dispatched out. So that's 120 hours out. And for our population, and forgive me for talking hurricanes and not winter storm here or nor'easter. So for the segment of the population that have dependencies on transportation, who can't get themselves out of here, there is a state contract for charter buses to come into the area. And they need to know at 114 hours before the arrival of tropical storm force winds, how many folks that's gonna be. And we have, you know, planning numbers that we can give them, but that's 114 hours. And so once that's confirmed after 3 or 4 hours later, then those buses are on the way. And we know, based on history, that we may be right 1 out of 5 times. That storm, which is approaching, that we're starting to make those decisions that cost money, and how many times is that storm just gonna veer off and we're gonna be good to go? Then we have to turn the buses around, but we're still on the hook for that. So there's obviously we're always gonna err on the side of safety. We're going to make sure that the folks get the resources that they need. And quite frankly, Hurricane Matthew for us was not that significant of event as you consider what happened in Carolina and further down the coast. And so we take these opportunities to really work through our plans. We treat them as full-scale exercises, really, because we have to deploy resources. And how often do you go through the process of fully deploying resources, either through mutual aid from our regional partners or from the state or our federal partners, unless there's an incident like this? So again, we treat these as not only exercises, full-scale exercises, but we always have a hot wash meeting afterwards, after action meetings to talk about what went right, what didn't go right, what can we build on, and where we need to improve. And again, our plans are always improved based on those discussions. But again, these tools allow us to make some better forecast decisions on where to evacuate. Just curious, so if a storm is coming our way, a nor'easter or otherwise, how would you get information? How would you expect to get information on whether you need to evacuate? Anybody know?
TV.
TV? Okay.
Radio.
We would, well, first of all, we will send you a message through Norfolk Alert. Norfolk Alert is our alert notification system, and we can send geographically targeted messages, whether there's a rabid animal in your neighborhood, and we've gotten calls to make those calls out from public health. If you are vulnerable to surge flooding, we will send you an alert. Now, many of you, I'm going to assume, have landline phones, right? Okay, there are some that don't. And so there's a segment of our population that got rid of their landline phones because it's more convenient and cheaper to have one cell phone that you can take with you everywhere. We can't reach you. We can reach your landline because it's connected to the Verizon's database, which is connected to our 911 center. So we will send you an alert, and it'll hit all the landlines in here. But if you don't have a landline, you won't get that message. unless you subscribe. You have to subscribe. And we have a problem, we have a challenge trying to get folks to subscribe to Norfolk Alert because people want to tell the government what their contact information would be. And I get it. I get it. I can tell you, I mean, and you would have to take my word, we're not going to sell your information. We don't even see your information. That information wouldn't come to play until we draw that hectagon or whatever shape file on a map to send a message your way. But if we can't contact you, we can't alert you. And so there are ways that you can register for Norfolk Alert, whether from your device or your computer, or calling, again, our impact center at 664-6510, and they'll help you register. But again, if we can't reach you, we can't alert you. And that is our number one way. We had a meeting this morning to talk about evacuation zones. We're looking at having six different scenarios and pretty much three different zones. The problem with evacuation zones that we've seen is that there's so much confusion. Why am I in this zone and not? Why is my neighbor across the street being evacuated and I'm not? We never flood. Why am I in this zone? Or when the storm is coming, what zone am I in? And you try to communicate that on the website, or you try to tell folks, you know, the lowest lying areas, if you're vulnerable to flooding, if you're in a low lying area, you know, you need to evacuate. How many of you have been told you're in a low lying area? How many of you can define what a low lying area is? And so there's so much confusion. So my school of thought was, if you get an alert, then that's really, there's really nothing to debate. We're telling you that you're vulnerable to, based on the parameters of this storm, you're vulnerable to experience flooding. Now, someone mentioned the TV media. And yeah, I mean, they would certainly help. They have the scrolling bar down at the bottom. But if you think about it, there's 17 localities just in Hampton Roads, not taking into account those that are in North Carolina. And so there's only so much airtime that they're going to be able to communicate the strategies for each locality. So again, we have Channel 48, and Brett in the back does a fantastic job putting the information out through those means. Radio, same thing. We, you know, WNIS on the AM dial, or you know, the 93.7 and the Coast and the Wave and all those. Again, fighting for airtime, and there's no FCC requirement that they report that information. But we are signing an agreement with Norfolk State 91.1 for Norfolk specific information. If it's going to be a federally declared incident, we're telling folks that, and we're working out the time where it's, you know, every hour on the hour, or every, you know, quarter after the hour, half after, whatever it is, tune in, Norfolk specific information, no other locality, Norfolk specific information, and then tune it out and save your battery. You know, if we're, you know, worried about power outages and the like, you'll get Norfolk specific information, not have to wait through all the other localities to get your information. So we're doing everything that we can to get the information out as best we can. But again, number one, first and foremost, is going to be Norfolk Alert. We mentioned our impact center, 664-6510. We look for information and we try to put information out through the tablets, smartphones, and our website. And again, our technology. Fraser Picard, Kyle Spencer do a fantastic job. So as we get information of damages, down trees, down lines, impacted roads, we're putting those on a map, not only to collect that data, to put out, to request funding, but to give you situational awareness. If you at your computer want to see what's going on in Norfolk at this time, you should be able to get that iView just going to norfolk.gov. Now, it's getting even better. There's exciting news that we were talking about earlier through our IT department. How many of you use a program called Waze? Okay, because it tells you where the officers are on the way there and if they're still there. It's the same concept. So when we get reports on down trees, down lines, and the like, and they're on that map for good. There's nothing to go back and ask you, is that road still flooded? And it may or may not be, but unless we send someone out there to verify that the threat's no longer there, it's still going to be red on that map. And so the picture may be good for a very brief time, but as soon as it's posted, it's old news. Waze will at least contact the I'm assuming the passenger, not the driver, the passenger, who will then say, you know, yes, this road is still flooded or it's not. So it's more real time. So we're getting the data that we need for future projects, but we're also giving folks more real time information that are out in the road or wondering if they should go out in the road. and certainly us in the emergency operations centers, where we have no windows, that is our window. That's allowing us to have a better idea of exactly what's going on. So with that,